to start our program because our speaker is going to talk with you for approximately 40, 45 minutes and then open it up for questions. And I'm sure after what you hear him and what he has to say today, you undoubtedly will have some questions. Let me just tell you what the program is going to be like today. The Seidel Challenge is going to be announced to the media at a press conference immediately following this presentation in this room. So if you would, please remain seated. There will be some people who will enter from the social room at 3 o'clock and be seated very quickly, and there'll be a platform party, and our president will make the presentation then to our dean of the check for the Seidel Challenge. The reason that we wanted to do this, to make this Seidel Challenge announcement on the same day that our Ryle lecture is going to be here, is because we thought that the spirit of both contributing individuals was the same. We thought that that whole idea of promoting youth development was a common goal that the Seidels and, of course, Luis Garden-Acosta share. And so, I think that you'll, after you hear what Mr. Garden-Acosta has to say today, and knowing what you know about Samuel and Marilyn Seidel, you'll agree with me. I can give you lots of remarkable facts about Luis Garden-Acosta, founder and president of El Puente. El Puente's won numerous awards. I'm going to read a couple of them to you. The Hispanic Federation Community Organization of the Year Award for exemplary leadership in education. The 2000 New York City Department of Health Community Organization of the Year Award for outstanding programs in community health, especially in early childhood asthma education. The 1999 National Endowment for the Arts and the President's Committee on the Arts and Humanities Coming Up Taller Award, recognizing 10 national organizations for outstanding arts programs nurturing the creative promise of young people. And Mr. Garden-Acosta, founder and president of El Puente, and Francis Lucerna, founding principal of El Puente Academy for Peace and Justice, received the Heinz Award for the Human Condition. The list goes on. And while I read the facts, I was impressed. But the facts didn't tell me what I really wanted to know. I really wanted the story behind the facts. I wanted to know how it's possible to transform a community where, in a single year, 48 young people were killed, into one where young people are starring in Broadway shows and winning Tony Awards, graduating from top universities in the country, defeating the construction of 55-story trash incinerators, and publishing research findings in scientific journals, prestigious scientific journals. How does one create the first public high school, El Puente Academy for Peace and Justice, focused on human rights? How does one forge partnerships between 12 and 20-year-olds and senior citizens? How does one garner national recognition through fostering an integrated arts curricula where students explore science, cultural rituals, labor issues, and a global economy, and communicate their understandings through artistic expressions? Well, that's why we invited Luis Garden-Acosta here to talk with us today, to find out how one person does, in fact, make transformations like this happen.
Thank you, Pat. And thank you all. It stopped raining. I've never been to Salisbury, and it really is beautiful. With all the rain that I saw, it was just a beautiful landscape. So I congratulate you all for having this wonderful space in which to reflect. I must confess, I am going to really depart from my plan. Something about the turbulence on the train, on the plane this morning, had me think about the anniversary we were dealing with today. Today, a whole plane of largely Dominicans crashed about a minute after takeoff from Kennedy. And in fact, four or five buses left from and went through this morning at 6:30 in the morning for the memorial. I was thinking about that, and I was thinking about how it is that we're alive and how it is that we come to be here at Salisbury. Thinking about my own life, thinking about what happened on September 11th, where we lost so many people, but where we at Puente lost our valedictorian, straight A student, 20-year-old, who had been given all kinds of scholarships, but turned them all down to stay in the city and work and help out her parents. And that's what she was doing when that first plane struck. And I started thinking about my own life, and it just so happens, Dr. Richards had, I guess, this sort of plan to egg me on, I guess, to talk about things I never talk about. I will be talking about El Puente tonight, and some of the things that she mentioned and more we'll be going through as to how we accomplished it. But I think it's time for me to reflect, and if I have your indulgence, I'll try to do some of that with you. And so this is not quite prepared, so I hope that you'll work with me on this. I, at 22, was a member of John Lindsay, a very progressive mayor in the city of New York, a member of his staff. I went on to become a leader of the Young Lords Party in Massachusetts while a student at Harvard Medical School. Now, for those of you who may not have heard about the Young Lords Party, I guess the shortcut version of the definition would be that we were like the Latino version of the Black Panther Party that you might have heard about. I have helped run a major hospital institution and helped close it down because it was out of compliance. I founded and I've led El Puente with a lot of support for the past 20 years as a way of struggling to realize the United Nations Universal Charter for Human Rights in North Brooklyn. So where did this start? I think it started in kindergarten, to be honest. You know, I didn't know a word of English when I first went to school, and I remember that I heard my mother and father raising their voice to each other, something that was not done, about me. And I realized it was about school, whatever that was. And my mother wanted me to have a religious education. She wanted me to go to Catholic school where I would be safe. And my father, an ex-amateur boxer, wanted me to go to public school where I'd be tough. My mother, of course, won. And so there I was in kindergarten. And I knew the sort of universal symbol for something bad, you know? And so the kids got around me and started saying, what I realized now was, Sister Karina, he said something bad. Now, I knew what they were saying. Obviously, I didn't say that bad word because I didn't speak English. I didn't know any English words. And Sister Karina was looking down at me and said, Mr. Garden, is this true? And I was mute. I still feel that in my body. I still feel my inability to express myself. I still feel that an injustice was done and I could not defend myself. So I think it started there, this question of justice and this sort of drive to defend those that are oppressed. My father died when I was 7. He was a hard hat at the Navy Yard in Brooklyn. So we lived in Fort Greene Projects, which at that time was the largest housing project in the world. And it was rather integrated. You had to have some kind of military or federal connection to get in there. They were put up real fast. Nobody ever thought that anybody would need a parking lot, for example. One of my pet peeves growing up. But it was nice. You know, I had relatives who lived in tenements, and it was not so nice. So, you know, even though it was ultimately the lowest of the low-income housing projects, we were a big scale up. No roaches in our house, no problems of any kind. You know, it was safe. We didn't have to worry about fires. And it was nice, you know, until my father died when I was 7. And then we lived what can only be described as some kind of subsistence struggle. We were eligible for welfare, but my mother wouldn't have it. I saw my mother cry twice in her life. Once when she came back from the hospital, and my father had died. And another one, she went to the welfare office. The only times I've ever seen my mother cry. And she was crying. And I said, "Ma, what's wrong?" She says, "I'm never going back there. They humiliated me. I'm never going back there. I'm never going back there. Whatever we have to do, we will do, but I'm never going back there." So I didn't know who these horrible people were in the welfare department, but I knew that something horrible had happened, that my mother was crying. My mother was forced to go and become a seamstress again in a sweatshop in Brooklyn, and asked the lady downstairs, we lived on the 4th floor, she lived on the 1st floor of the building, to take care of us. And it was fine. She had a couple of sons, I had a great time, until there was a knock on the door. "Rush, it's the investigator." I said, "What's going on here?" "Shh, quiet, follow us. Get underneath the bed." Now, I can't tell you what it's like to be a preschool child and be forced to get under a bed and hide and be told that I cannot say a word because the investigator is here, the welfare investigator, who would have docked my neighbor's checks, her puny, less than poverty level checks, because she dared collect a small income from my mother for taking care of me. Later, fresh out of the seminary, I was a student for the Catholic priesthood and out of the monastery, just left before taking vows. I had belonged to an order called the Redemptorist Order, the Congregation of the Most Holy Redeemer. It's a Catholic religious order. And their motto was, we go to the most abandoned, the most oppressed. And when I found myself back home, I said, well, who's the most abandoned, the most oppressed? I mean, how can I work this out as a lay person, maybe as part of a lay priesthood? Since I had some issues with the church at that time about its conduct in the civil rights movement, or its lack of commitment to opening up and leading the effort to bring us together. So it wasn't so much that I didn't want to become a priest, it was that I had some real issues about how that particular order, and I later found out so many other parts of the church were being moved, that I felt was part of the same kind of white supremacy that we had to work against. So I thought about it. And in our society, the most oppressed and most abandoned are people on welfare, because if you're homeless, if you have nothing, you are eligible, at least at that time, for welfare, for some sort of public assistance in New York City. And a bunch of us got together and thought, you know, why don't we organize welfare clients? Why don't we try to sort of demand some minimum standards here? And lo and behold, we read the law And there was minimum standards. Well, welfare recipients were supposed to get all kinds of things, but unlike the Social Security office, when you come in and they flood you with pamphlets about all that you're eligible for, when you walk into a welfare office, you have no idea what you're eligible for. You think if you luck out, you might get on the rolls. But it's a mystery as to what you're, it's not like somebody gives you a pamphlet, did you know that you're eligible for this, for that, for the other thing? No. On the contrary, they want to dissuade you from even thinking about your eligibility and want to find a way that you are not eligible. So most welfare recipients did not know that there was a requirement in the law that they have so many socks to wear, so many razor blades to use. It was down there in the regs. So a bunch of us said, well, why don't we just call for meetings? I actually put up leaflets all over the community. You come to my meeting, and I guarantee you no less than $500. I never had a meeting with less than 100 people. And I guaranteed it, and I came through, because everybody had been they had totally been dissuaded that they were not eligible for actually monies and resources that were part of the law and part of regulations. So I could come through with that pledge. We organized a citywide coordinating committee of welfare groups in New York, much to the chagrin and abusive comments of a lot of commentators in the press. But then we went on and organized the National Welfare Rights Office in Washington, D.C., and I think most of you, or some of you might have known about the efforts there to try to move for a guaranteed annual income, an unfortunate use of words, I think, when I look back. But a security belt that was consistent throughout the country. Now, as a ex-welfare rights organizer, I found myself with kind of ex-core civil rights workers, people who had worked for various parts of the civil rights movement. And there we were in New York, and this shining kind of political leader decides that he, though he's Republican, wants to run for mayor. An impossible feat, because no Republican at that time could be elected mayor of New York City. And the man was John Lindsay, a man I grew to respect a great deal. And John Lindsay wanted to really bring in people like me into government. And he said, you know, he wants to all of us to ride on a tide of reform and to really move government to serve the people. So after we grilled him, are you for real? Do you really want us? And he seemed to say yes. So we went in. And there for 3 years, it's about 1967 to 1969, a little less than 3 years, I learned what it was to work inside government. I understood how the decisions were made and how the politics moved the city and how even good people like the Lindsay administration could be moved in a different direction than what they intended to move in because of other established interests. And I felt very strongly that I really wasn't going to be able to serve my community inside government at that point. I'd learned enough, but that if enough of us didn't go to the communities back home, if we didn't create our strong political basis there, if democracy couldn't be practiced in Fort Greene, in Williamsburg, in Bushwick, in Washington Heights, in Harlem, in Bedford-Stuyvesant, then it didn't matter who was in City Hall, because there would not be a very strong force in the direction of positive progressive acts on behalf of all the people. So I got heavily involved in organizing my community around issues of poverty. I got heavily involved in the anti-war movement from its earliest days. We were there. I think I went to every single major mobilization in Washington, D.C., and to this day, if you look at any pictures of the 60s, of those huge mobilizations, there's always a Puerto Rican flag. Look for it. And underneath that Puerto Rican flag is moi. And then, but something was like gnawing at me. I had lived a wonderful life of community in my nearly 4 years in the seminary and monastery. And I really understood that. And I was trying to sort of live that out in my own community. And something was missing, that sort of camaraderie, that commitment, that sense of discipline, that focused sense that you have as a member of an order. And I just kept looking for it, maybe in the anti-war movement, maybe in the welfare rights movement, a little bit Lindsay administration, never quite finding it, never quite connecting with it. It wasn't really there until one week when I heard about some young people who were trying to get a church in East Harlem that was only used for 3 hours on a Sunday morning to be used the entire week to feed people, to have soup kitchens and breakfast, to have classes in Puerto Rican history. There were none in the city of New York. To provide clothing for people who were cold in East Harlem, to do all the things that I think everybody in this room believes ought to be done. And those young people went by the name of an old gang in Chicago called the Young Lords. They had come into the church, and it was a Protestant church, and at a time when people can get up and talk about their feelings, they did get up and talk about their feelings. The leader of the Young Lords spoke to why they were there and what they wanted the church to do. And at that very moment, the minister nodded his head to plainclothes police officers who were in the church, who went outside, got the uniformed police officers to come in, and they beat all of these young people. There was blood spilled all over that church. They broke the leader's arm. It was a horror. It was such a horror that it was in all the press, and of course we all heard about it. It was international news. And so the next Sunday, I'm at the First Spanish Methodist Church in East Harlem, along with hundreds of others, and to meet these young people. And at that moment, I decided I would be one of them. And I became a Young Lord, which was a bit of a process. I had to be okayed by all kinds of people all over the world, I think. Because the Young Lords at that time, and rightfully so, were so afraid of infiltration. The COINTELPRO program that Washington had funded by millions was really doing its work. The Panthers believed that half of them could be on the take. And that's the leadership of the Panther Party telling us, look, we don't even trust our members, so don't do it the way we did it. Be very selective. Have a small number of people you really trust, make them your members, and everyone else, give them some kind of other status. So we invented the rally lord concept. In other words, sometimes you see, we had a major demonstration as Young Lords, 10,000 of us at the UN, demanding the independence of Puerto Rico. Well, obviously, the Young Lords were only a couple hundred. So who were those other 10,000 you saw in berets, and looking rather militant and fierce? They were rally lords. They got their beret for the rally, they had to turn it in afterwards, and if they behaved themselves, they got to be rally lord again. but these are little known secrets of the radical 60s. But even then, we were still infiltrated, and that's another story. As a Young Lord, though, I was leading under the guidance of Juan Gonzalez, who's now a top columnist in the country, works for the New York Daily News, award-winning columnist. I was leading the effort of what we call the Health and Education Ministry, particularly the area of health. So we were dealing with looking at this whole question of lead poisoning. We were the first to really look at it. And it was very hard because we were drawing bloods with medical students, and it was very archaic given how we do it now, a little pinprick. But we were coming to grips with the notion that we were slowly poisoning our young people by way of the lead that was in the walls, on the paint. And that the health department hadn't really focused on this, and it was not at the top of the public health agenda, and we had to do that, and we did. And that led me to move and talk to a lot of medical students all over the country, and I wound up one day speaking to a large group of medical students at Harvard. And a couple came to me afterwards and said, you know, what are you doing? I mean, you sound like you're really into health. I said, yeah, I am. As a matter of fact, when I was in seminary, the plan was that I was going to go to medical school. And they said, well, are you thinking about it? I said, well, I'm always thinking about it, but right now we're dealing with the revolution. So they said, well, you know, you could come to Harvard. And I said, really? They said, well, it's one of the few places that can afford somebody like you, and you won't have to worry about anything. I mean, they'll pay for everything. It's a blind admission, so if they admit you, they pay for it. I said, wow, I always thought it was some kind of a scholarship or something that, you know, you had to write 1,000 pages on or something, and, you know, you win at the end of the year or something. And I said, no, it's about being accepted. I said, okay. So anyway, one thing led to another. I was accepted to Harvard Medical School. Only to be thrown out every year. I was there for 3 years. I was thrown out 3 times. And every year they had to bring me back because they couldn't quite get me on academics. After that, the third year, I just said, look, why don't we call this a draw and I take leave of absence? They said, great. So I went to Western Massachusetts and decided that I would recuperate from that craziness, from being the leader of the Young Lords Party in Massachusetts, and try to sort of, you know, kind of like get into just being a member of the community. But I saw this huge radio station, and while at Harvard, I taught video on the side, and I said, well, just carrying this video equipment, I don't know if you knew what it was like in those days. I mean, today it's like unbelievable, small little camera, and it does incredible work. Then it was carrying this huge tape recorder, open reel, and the camera, and the stand, and the lights, and the monitor. I mean, it was outrageous, you know. And after a while, you sort of said, I don't really have to film that today, do I? But there was a radio station, a very powerful radio station on campus. And I walked in one day to WMUA and said, listen, I've been listening to WMUA. It's a good station. Broad, Massachusetts, Vermont. But you're missing something. I said, what? You have no Latino programming. You have no Latin American news. Nobody knows anything about what's happening in Latin America. There's a huge Latin American community here. And I'm willing to do 5 minutes a week. And we started with 5 minutes. 5 minutes became 15 minutes. 15 became 1 hour. 1 hour became 3 hours, a three-hour music show, no longer a strictly news show, but a music-based show on the politics of health. And I became Dr. Salsa, the nation's only public health disc jockey. By the way, the number one rated radio show in its time slot in Western Massachusetts, beat out everybody was listening to Dr. Salsa. In fact, it was crazy. I mean, one day my producer was in Boston interviewing, I think, McGovern, and there was the special assistant, Ms. Peterson, the special assistant to President Carter in the White House, special assistant for consumer affairs. And she went up to her, and Mrs. Peterson asked, what radio station are you from, or what program? She says, oh, Dr. Salsa. She says, Dr. Salsa? You work for Dr. Salsa? And of course, my producer felt, oh, this is a politician. You know, she's never heard us. I listen to Dr. Salsa all the time. And my producer said, well, Mrs. Peterson, we only broadcast in Western Massachusetts. We don't reach Washington, D.C. She said, I know that. I just do it for my farm in Vermont. Dr. Salsa's great. Can he come to visit me in the White House? She said, yeah, bring your whole staff. That's how she became a board member of Dr. Salsa's medicine show. We did go to the White House. And that's how President Carter cleaned up my 60s sheet so that I could actually serve on the National Science Foundation board, panels, and stuff like that. And Carter, God bless him, is amazing. Now, I didn't know much about my mother's history. I think it had a lot to do with my being here. There was some secret. I didn't quite understand what was going on in the family. I thought it was just some love affair or something, you know. It was interesting that whenever someone would say the words, Albizu Campos, my mother would say, we don't talk like that here. And so I assumed it was some kind of a curse word in Spanish that I just wasn't familiar with, because my mother was a very religious woman and she wouldn't allow that kind of language in the house. It was a man. It was the last part of a name. Pedro Albizu Campos. Not just a man, but someone who had graduated top of his Harvard Law School class. Someone who had learned about struggling for independence by working with the Irish and supporting their independence and realizing that, you know what, he should go to Puerto Rico and move it there, and became the modern leader of the independence movement. And notwithstanding his great academic prowess and his amazing wisdom, he spent 20 years in American jails for daring to defy the U.S. presence in Puerto Rico and for demanding what is his right, what is his human right, the independence of his country. I didn't know that. I didn't really know why my mother was here. I just assumed that it was because of the horrible poverty, that somehow she got on a boat in the 30s and got here. My mother was never able to go to school. She doesn't know how to read or write. She prides herself on being able to sign her name. You know, school was not an option for her if she was to survive, so many did not. And my father had told me how horrible things were in the Dominican Republic, so I'm assuming my mother went through the same kinds of things in Puerto Rico, and both of them, in a way, in a major way, were here because of the horrible poverty, but that wasn't the case at all. I later found that my father was not only dealing with the issue of poverty, but really upset at the turn the government had taken at Trujillo, the dictator, and wanted nothing of it. My uncle, I later found out, was president of the province of Puerto Plata. And so my father felt that that was too close. And so he just took off. And my poor mother, a week before she was to be married, as my aunt told me later, she actually, her fiance took her to her friend's house who was making the wedding dress. This was Palm Sunday, and she was going to be married on Easter Sunday. And her fiance said, listen, you just make the dress or work on the dress, and I'll be back to pick you up. She says, where are you going? I'm going to the march. I said, I don't think you should go to that march. It's going to be trouble. She said, nah, it's not going to be trouble. It's just going to be a march. I'm going to have kids there, and it's just, you know, we've got to stand up for our independence. And if there is trouble, believe me, I'd rather die as a man than deal with what we're dealing with now. She was very worried. Sure enough, government troops opened up on a peaceful march, killed 22 people, 140 others injured, including children, and one of them, my mother's fiance, who was said to have taken his blood and scribbled on the sidewalk, Que viva Puerto Rico libre. Long live Puerto Rico free. My mother was so distraught. So hurt that she just was out of it. She just couldn't deal with this reality. Our family was so poor that it took them about a year and a half to raise enough money to put her on a boat and send her to relatives in New York, where they hoped she might forget. And so that's how my mother met my father. And that's a major reason why I'm here. But you know, I didn't know this until I became a young lord. I came home, showed my mother the beret. My mother looks at me, looks at the beret, and starts screaming. I mean, really screaming. You know, we have this thing, especially in Puerto Rico, about el ataque, a sort of emotional attack, you know, this hysteria. Well, she had it. And I didn't know what was going on. You know, you don't like the beret? What? What is going on? My aunt took me to the side. She says, "You don't know what you've done." I said, "What are you talking about?" And she told me the whole story. She says, "Your mother is right now very much afraid that you'll die also." And with good reason, some of us did. You know, I think that people listen to my story about the young lords and say, well, you know, that was a different time, and he made a decision to go a very radical route. I would never do something like that. But my issues and my thirst for justice have less to do with young lords. Young lords were a convenient organization to get linked up to express what I was feeling, and more to do with what happened in kindergarten, and more to do with being under a bed hiding from a welfare investigator, and more to do with living in a what became a horrible gang-ridden housing project where kids, where my best friend was knifed to death, and more to do with dealing with racism, where when I took my all Cub Scout patrol and brought them to my Boy Scout troop, my white scoutmaster and assistant scoutmaster were shocked and took me to the side and said, basically, we can't handle kids like that. And more to do with Walter O'Malley, the owner of the Brooklyn Dodgers. You know, think about it. I was a top altar boy, as you might get a sense of. And one of the things, one of the goodies about being an altar boy was you got tickets to Ebbets Field every Saturday. So I made sure I was the best. I got to go to Ebbets Field just about every Saturday that the Brooklyn Dodgers were playing in Ebbets Field. My life centered around the Brooklyn Dodgers. I loved them. I thought they were great. Duke Snyder, I mean, all these guys were like heroes to me. And then one day, I was a paper boy as a way of helping my mom out, because we all had to do, I mean, I was basically always had a job. It was the only way that we survived. A Social Security check, which was way below the standards of even welfare, and any job that I can get. And I had a paper route, and I sold greeting cards, and I sold my mother's handkerchiefs that she sewed. I mean, I did everything I could do. But on this paper route, I think it was a Wednesday, the headlines and all that people were talking about was this guy, this owner of the Brooklyn Dodgers, and they were talking about him in very derisive terms. They were cursing his name, adults in front of me, and they didn't care. And everywhere I went delivering this paper, they'd look at it and they started cursing. And everybody was super upset. I'm going, what's going on here? Why are people upset with this guy? And they said, well, this guy is taking the Brooklyn Dodgers away from Brooklyn. I said, I'm young, but I'm not stupid. Nobody can take the Brooklyn Dodgers from Brooklyn. They're the Brooklyn Dodgers. That's what they are. They're Brooklyn Dodgers. You can't take them out of Brooklyn. They wouldn't be the Brooklyn Dodgers. I said, son, Brooklyn Dodgers are owned by one man. I said, what? I thought the city owned them. I thought Brooklyn owned them. Aren't they Brooklyn? And they said, yeah, but they're Brooklyn, but they're not. They're not ours. What do you mean they're not ours? They are ours. These are the Brooklyn Dodgers. These are our people. I said, no, that's not the way it works. you know, somebody owns them. And because they own them, they can take them away. So you can't take away the Brooklyn Dodgers. They belong to a city. And finally, they convinced me that one human being could destroy the hopes and desires of an entire city, at least those that weren't rooting for the Yankees. I was shocked. I think that has more to do with why I'm here today. I mean, how in a democracy can one person decide to do that to the home team? So, yes, I was a young lord, but please don't mistake how I came to be here with you today. It was these real life experiences of seeing oppression constantly and then seeing good people turn away. And understanding that I couldn't do that. I was a Christian, culturally Catholic. I clearly understood the Sermon on the Mount. You gave me to eat when I was hungry, to drink when I was thirsty. You visited me when I was imprisoned, clothed me when I was naked, sheltered me when I was homeless. And of course, people at the end of the world would say, well, when did we do this? We didn't even see you. Because you did it to the most depressed. You did it to me. And that is the commandment. And that's what I have to follow. And on top of that, I live in a democracy where we are supposed to express our will, where collectively we can make decisions about our wellness, about how we raise our children, about the environment we create in our country. Now, obviously, enough of us don't do that. Obviously, when you have, you know, the sort of the minimum standard of involvement in a democracy, I guess, is voting once every couple of years, and that's really minimum. And only 1/3 of the electorate did it last week. Only 1/3 of those eligible to vote did it. And that's less than, that eligible to vote group is less than half the people anyway. So a minority of people in this country have decided who are our representatives and who are the policymakers. And we've stood by that, by and large, and are doing nothing. So I hope I've been able to share with you a little bit about how it is that I got to be here, and what's the backdrop of what you'll be hearing tonight. And I want to thank you for allowing me to share some of these flashbacks and what I now can see was a pilgrimage of resistance. All of us who make a commitment to people and not to profit, to struggle and not to salary, to conviction and not always to a career, respond to a sacred calling in human history. Our vocation is a holy one, for it compels us above all to heal the breach, to repair that which is torn, to make whole the human soul, to create community. In a society that mythologizes the individual, that in practice confers an aura of sanctity on the wealthy, it is an act of resistance to choose the path of humanity. At a time when 33 million Americans go to bed hungry every night, where over 1 billion people on our planet have no daily access to clean water, it is an act of resistance to love and care for each other. It is an act of resistance to reject the superficial, the so-called 15-minute hype of celebrity. It is an act of resistance to pledge one soul to the profound, to the mastery of what makes us human. And as some today beat the drums of war, it is an act of resistance to insist on peace. And always, and always, and forever, act justly to demand and stand for social justice. Thank you. I didn't tell you about Williamsburg, the third hippest place to live in America, where I come from. Totally different world from Salisbury these days, the new Soho. I'll talk about that tonight and about what that means to the different capitals that exist in Williamsburg, the Hasidic capital, Latino capital, and everyone else, and all the different struggles for peace and justice that we've gone through in the past 20 years. But if there are any questions related to anything I said and about anything, I'd be happy to entertain them. Yes? No, that was Western Mass at University of Massachusetts. Yeah, it had the most powerful radio station in Western Mass. Oh, I was actually doing a little teaching public health and taking some courses, really biding my time and figuring out when I was supposed to go back to medical school. Right. Oh, great place. Great place. Love that place. You can ask me anything about who's Don Pedro Alviso Campos and get into that, or Young Lords, or anything. Okay. Thank you very much.